What's up, Strong Complex? Happy Thursday. Good evening, Kate Queen. We got 4 minutes. Hey Vanessa, happy Thursday. Hallelujah. She said, your miracle is right here. It is right here for you. How many miracles would we be walking in right now if we stopped waiting for the miracle and started walking in the miracle? Working in the miracle is what I actually was going to say. Stop waiting for the miracle and start working in the miracle. How would my life be different if I stopped living like I was in expectation for something and lived as if I've been given everything that I need right now? We got 2 minutes, so I won't go too deep, but all I'm saying is that God has given us everything that we need to succeed. If he knew us before we even got here, which he did, if he had the entire thing mapped out before he ever placed us here in this thing called life, why would God set you up for failure and not for success? I think sometimes the only reason we are failing in areas that God has called us, created us, and anointed us to succeed in is simply because we don't know Jesus. Broken pieces is what we're talking about today. And you just got here. We're not even supposed to be starting yet. I don't know where we're going. It's Bible study. And I was asking God, Lord, what do you have to say? Lord, what do you have to say? And I know where I want to go, but I don't know where he's going to go. We're going to give it one more minute. And once I get my help, we're moving forward. We can start with prayer and go from there. We're going to be in Matthew chapter 7. We're going to be in Matthew chapter 7. Give it 30 more seconds until this time switches. I thought I was late, child. Hey, Keith. No, you're right on time. First day here, glad to be here. I'm happy you're here too. Listen, I posted, and am I late? That's terrible. Y'all always be that clearly, y'all always be late. Am I late? No, y'all are right on time. We have not got started. I'm waiting one more minute. Well, probably less than a minute now. Oh, but I posted a new episode on my podcast. I wanna say this first. I wanna say thank you to every single person that supports me, sticks with me, stays with me, that loves on me. Y'all are amazing. I was posting my podcast episode today and I looked at my analytics on the podcast app. Y'all really been listening to my podcast. That's so crazy to me. Y'all have really been listening to my podcast and there has not been a new episode. In fact, the episode I posted is season 2, episode 1, because the season 2 I started just was trash. So I love you back. So thank you guys for that. I was like, oh, that's tragic. Y'all been listening to the same episodes, but praise God that they're blessing you. I think that they're horrible sometimes. Sometimes you can't see yourself the way that other people see you. So it's important that you do not walk by your own understanding of yourself, but you walk by how God defines you and how he uses other people to define you. Yes, it's on Apple Podcasts. It's the Ascension Podcast on Spotify and on Apple. But guess what? I made it even simpler for you. All you have to do is click the link in my bio and it's all linked right there. We don't have time to be typing stuff in. Just click the link and it'll take you there. It'll be simple. You're changing lives. Thank you. We're moving. I think that's the goal of it all. I think the goal of it all is to change lives. Let's pray. Oh, Father. Lord, we need you. Father, I ask that you have your way in this moment. I ask that you press beyond all fear, all anxiety, all worry, all doubt, all ounces of overthinking that try to occur even while my mouth is moving. I don't know how I'm overthinking and talking at the same time. Lord, help us. God, I invite you into this moment. I invite you into this atmosphere, oh God. You said it was my responsibility to prepare my heart, and that you would give me what to say in the midst of that preparation. So God, here I am just preparing my heart posture for you. God, no, I can't say that we've got it all together. God, I can't say that we've got it all figured out. I wish that we could come before your throne saying that we're a little bit better than we are, but I come to find that the power does not come from us and what we have and how great we are. It doesn't come from our skill sets. It doesn't come from our gifts or our abilities. Our power is... it only comes when we don't have any of ourselves. I heard the Bible say that your strength is only made perfect in our weakness. So God, if there's anything that I'm asking for in this moment, it's that you can show me even now that broken pieces really do have purpose, oh God, that as I bring every ounce of my inadequacy, every ounce of my humanity into your presence, as I bring you the natural, you'll add the super, oh God, and that we'll leave changed, oh God. I don't want us to have just an entertaining experience. God, there is so many other things that we could be doing. But God, if we're going to be in this moment at this hour and at this time, God, I ask that your glory come, Lord. We're not just here for fun. I'm telling you, they didn't just come to see my face, Lord. We're here for your glory. So Father, if you don't show up in this moment, there will be no moment. This will just be a waste of our time. But God, if you can just dwell with us, if you could just tabernacle with us, if you could just hang out with us for a moment, I promise I won't steal too much of your time, God, if you could just come and show yourself to be true. Lord, speak a word that does not just impact the people, but I'll even selfishly ask, speak something that impacts me also. God, don't let me say something out of my own intellect and understanding, but let prophecy come forth. Let it be in complete alignment with your will, your way, and what it is that you're desiring to say to your people in this season, at this hour, right now. God, I know you to be a right now, God. I heard the Bible say that now faith. It didn't say expired faith. It didn't say faith for 2 hours from now. Right now, in this moment, God, I call on you to just be who you are. Provision, strength, healing, deliverance, restoration. One person needs peace. Another person needs to pay. We all need different things, but we're connected by our human experience. God, I ask that you just show me how to connect the pieces. Lord, lead us, guide us, carry us, guard us, and guarantee us in all things by your Spirit. Father, I thank you. I thank you because I understand that I'm not asking for anything that is not already done. God, I know that you desire to be with us. You said, ask and you shall receive, seek and you shall find, knock and the door shall be open. So God, I'm not asking for anything out of your hand. I'm just asking for everything that's within your heart. God, have your way as I move out of it. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. Let's do this. We're in Matthew chapter 7. Judge not that you be not judged. For with what judgment you judge, you will be judged. I think we forget that none of us are better than the other. I think we as humans have really succumbed to thinking that we are better than someone else. And I heard the Bible say, judge and you shall be judged. That with the same measure you use, it will be measured back to you. And why do you look at the speck in your brother's eye, but do not consider the plank in your own eye? Hey, Destiny, I saw you in Target. Hey, did you see me and say, hey, or did you see me and keep on moving? Because if you saw me and said, hey, then I know who you are. But if you saw me and kept moving, you should have said, hey. And why do you look at the speck in your brother's eye, but do not consider the plank in your own eye? Why do you think that you're better? I think as Christians, even as it relates to the Pharisees and the scribes and the scholars and people back in that day, right? When we look at their problems, when we look at God's frustrations with the people, it was simply that they started to believe they were better than everyone else. They had got so intellectually sound in Jesus. They had got so deep in Jesus from a head place, not a heart place, a head place, that when God himself was standing before them, because they knew so much of him but didn't really know him, they were not able to acknowledge and seize that opportunity and that moment to see God face to face. Have you seen God face to face? Let's just get through the text first. Or how can you say to your brother, let me remove the speck from your eye and look, a plank is in your own eye? How can I show you how to do something that I myself have never done? You can teach someone how to tie their shoe because you tie your shoe. I couldn't stand going to class. I asked my psychology professor a question, and because she didn't know the answer, she just gave me a bunch of aimless words to try to fill the space. I could respect you if you just said, I don't know, instead of you trying to teach me something you yourself don't know. You can't teach someone anything you have yet to learn. Hypocrite. First, remove the plank from your own eye, and then you will see clearly to remove the speck from your brother's eye. Do not give what is holy to the dogs, nor cast your pearls before swine, lest they trample them under their feet and turn and tear you in pieces. Ask, it will be given to you. Verse 7. Ask and it will be given to you. Seek and you will find. Knock and the door shall be open. Good to see you too, Ashley. For everyone, not just some people, not just specific people. You don't just need the bishop to pray for you. You just don't need to have a council session with your pastor. He's not the only one that can get through to God. The Bible says, for everyone who asks, receives. Now, understand, Jesus is on a mountain talking to disciples. He's teaching the people. If we go all the way back just a couple chapters, in chapter 5, and seeing the multitudes, he went up on a mountain, and when he was seated, his disciples came to him. Then he opened his mouth and taught them, saying, bam, then we go. I started to just read the Bible from Matthew chapter 5 onto chapter 7, and we can do that. What verse are we on? We're in Matthew chapter 7. And I was like, maybe we could do that. But Jesus is talking to his disciples. It's important that I make that clear so you as a Christian, as a disciple, as a child of God, can understand what it is that you have. When Jesus says, for everyone who asks, receives, he's saying that based on the group of everyone that he's talking to. Jesus is only talking to disciples, and we're in the New King James Version. He's only talking to disciples. He's not talking to people in the world. He's not talking to random everyday folk. He is talking to those who have been adopted into Jesus Christ. Obviously, this is Jesus, so it wasn't Jesus talking. That's not really what it was. He's talking to the children of God. As a child of God, you have the opportunity to have your prayers heard by God. A matter of fact, because it makes it sound like God is selective in his hearing. As a Christian, God hears your prayers. I'm not saying if Susie down the road goes and prays that God is going to hear her prayer. I'm not saying that if John or Jacob, who don't know Jesus for real, that I can't even say the people who have the most degrees. And I'm not saying God is hearing their prayer. But I'm saying to every single one of you who are a child of God, he hears you. Sometimes we're frustrated and sometimes we're overwhelmed because we think God is ignoring us. But I heard the Bible say his ear is not too heavy that he cannot hear us. He's omniscient, omnipotent, omnipresent, always existing, all-knowing. It's not that God can't hear us. Sometimes his silence is his best response. Everyone who asks receives. Do you go into your prayer time knowing that God is listening, and not only listening, that God is responding? I'm so thankful if I could just be a little bit, I don't know, what would that be, prideful? I'm thankful that I don't have to worship a statue. I'm sorry. Y'all be trying to thank God just for houses and just for cars. I don't do this for fake. I really just be happy I don't have to serve a statue. I just be happy I don't have to worry about carrying Jesus, but I can trust that God is carrying me. I don't have to worry about lifting up a statue, bowing down to worship a statue. I'm just happy that God is carrying me. I think sometimes we highlight the most simplistic blessings. Yeah, a house is a blessing. Okay, a car is a blessing. But even the devil can get a house and a car. You got witches in houses, and you got witches who have cars. Satanists have houses and cars. What we have that other people don't have is a God that will carry you, a God that will keep you. I've just been really resting in the blessing of God's keeping. God, you can do a whole bunch of things for my hand. You can give me more money. You can give me more influence, more followers, more likes, more comments. That's great. You can do a whole lot of stuff and place it in my hand. But God, I thank you for what you've given me in my heart. Somebody say I'm thankful. This is supposed to be Bible study, so we're going to study the Bible. But someone just say I'm thankful. It's good to see you, Jason. I'm thankful. God, I'm thankful. Not for what you've placed in my hand. I'm thankful for who you are in my heart. Are you going to God knowing that your prayers are not only being heard, but answered? Do you know what separates our God from every other God? Do you know what separates God, capital G, from every other God? Hey, Casey. Hallelujah. Our God responds to us. This is not opinion-based. This is factual. I'm about to dive into the theology of it. In the study of theology, spirituality, and divinity, when you look at different religions and spiritual practices, there is only one religion with a God that responds. That is us as Christians. So I'd rather go to people who won't respond to me and get mad because you're not validating me. You're invalidating me, rather than seeking after a God that has already validated me, has already qualified me, and responds to me. Why would I chase after someone who does not respond when I have a God that's already responding? I didn't say we have a God that responds, meaning I'm waiting for the response. I have a God that is yet responding right now. Why? Because we serve a right now type of God. Right now, now faith. Now hope doesn't disappoint. Hope deferred will make your heart sick. If you're carrying a deferred type of hope, if you're carrying brokenness, bitterness, and betrayal, hope deferred will make your heart sick. But now hope doesn't disappoint. Meaning if I'm ever willing to let go of what I have to receive who God is, not just to receive what God has, if I'm ever able to let go of what I've got to receive who God is, I'll have a now hope. Somebody say now hope. Now hope. I don't want a yesterday type of hope. I want a now hope. God, I need a now hope for my mind. God, I need a now hope for my money. I need a now hope for my ministry. I need a now hope for my family. God, I thought things were going to go a different way. I thought it was going to look a different way. I had a different expectation. And because I was disappointed and because it didn't go how I thought it was going to go, now my hope is deferred and my heart is getting sick. You think it's spiritual warfare? It's not spiritual warfare. Your heart is just sick. So how does my heart get well? I've got to be willing to let go of what I've got to receive who God is, and now I've got a new hope. I know I said say now hope. Now I want you to say a new hope. Just say new hope, new hope, new hope. I'm in expectation for a new hope. So we have a God that not only hears us, but a God that responds. I find that it is so necessary in this generation to break down the simplicity of who God is. He is complex because he's God. I say simplicity because he's the, what you call it? Simplicity because he's God. He reduced himself into these pages that we could come to some ounce of understanding who he is. You have to understand in this day and age who your God is. John chapter 4, Jesus says, the Father is no longer looking for people who are just going to worship him to say they're worshiping him. He's looking for people who are going to worship him in spirit and in truth. We know what we worship. You don't know what you worship. So your worship ain't really real. Ours is real because I'm worshiping from a place of intellect and understanding while also a spiritual place. The Bible says to pray in the spirit, which is speaking in tongues, but to also pray with an understanding. That means there absolutely are some areas of your life where knowledge and intellect are necessary. Yet it clearly defines that there will also be moments where that's unnecessary. I have to be willing to discern, does this moment require me or does this require Jesus? I have to be willing to tell the difference between areas I have to step into and areas I have to be willing to step out of. I'm a Christian. That's where I'm going. This is Bible study. I'm not about to just preach to y'all. This is Bible study. God responds. When you are able to get a clear understanding of the God that you serve, your warfare, your attacks, your pains, your heartaches, all of that will fade away because every ounce of my life experience has to alter itself to the word of God concerning my life. The only reason we experience chaos, calamity, and confusion that is seemingly unorganized or that seems like it's destroying us and killing us is because we are manipulating ourselves to that situation and circumstance rather than grabbing that situation and circumstance and manipulating it, conforming it. Be ye not conformed to this world, be transformed by the renewing of your mind, and conforming it to the word of God concerning our life. How can I conform something to something if I don't know the something? Say that a little bit better. How can I conform all of my life to the word of God concerning it if I don't know the word of God? How can I conform everything that I'm experiencing, every thought, my mind, my will, and emotions, how can I conform them to the word of God if I don't know the word of God concerning my life? God responds. When you go into prayer, I want you to be conscious of the fact that God responds. I've been having conversations lately, and I'm like, do you believe God answers prayers? Yeah, I do. Okay. So why don't you walk in the answer of the prayer? One girl talked to me, this was in person, and she was like, I was praying for something like this. I was praying for God to send me this person and blah, 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 blah. I'm like, okay, great. So you believe God answers prayers? Then if you prayed for it and you believe that God answers prayers, you should be fully present in this moment, understanding that this moment right now is ye the answer to your prayer. If you are not fully present in this moment, in the consciousness that this is the answer to your prayer, you'll take what was supposed to be a divine interaction and divine encounter and turn it into something random. Life is not random. We're walking the text, but life is not random. It is important as Christians, as believers, as people of the way, as children of God, whatever you qualify, quantify, and define yourself as long as you serve Jesus, you're all right with me. For us who are serving the Lord Jesus Christ, it is important that we know, that you know, everything is happening on purpose. Wait a minute, so someone commented and said, so wait, my brother had to die on purpose. Are you ready for that conversation? Yes. I leave that alone. I think that might be too deep. But yes, there was purpose there. What purpose? I don't know. But if God be purposeful and God be leading your life, all things are happening in purpose, by purpose, on purpose, for purpose. Which means my today is not punishment because of my yesterday. My today is preparation for my tomorrow. All things are working at the counsel of his will. Yes, I went through the heartbreak. I probably could have avoided the heartbreak. I just still went into that situation. I can't say God wanted me broken. I can't say God just wanted me depressed and feeling like my life is ending. No, what I can say is that what the enemy meant for evil, God still had a contingency, a plan to use it all for my good because everything is happening intentionally. Every single moment of your life when you are connected to the one true living God, I'm thankful that I serve a living God, happens on purpose. I'll go here. I don't know. Sometimes we try to deflect everything to the devil. We try to put so much power on the enemy. I was going to say pressure, but we just be giving him too much power. We try to deflect everything to him. Not understanding, I'm going to go here. Where am I going? Psalms, yes, it's familiar. We're going to get back to where I'm going, but we're just going to go here if I could divert for a moment. God not only hears you, God responds to you, right? It's important to know that we serve a God that responds. That way, when we pray, we don't just pray speaking a whole bunch of words, but we get up off of our knees walking that prayer out because God responds. Asking, you shall receive. See, asking, it will be given to you. Seeking, you will find. Knocking, it will be opened to you. Yes, the story of Job. I didn't touch on that. What's today's topic? It's going to be something about broken pieces and the purpose. If you just go with me, we're just having Bible study. We're just walking Bible. For everyone who asks, receives, and he who seeks, finds, and to him who knocks, it will be open, right? Let's go back here. Psalms 139. Where can I go from your spirit, or where can I flee from your presence? Robin, what's your point in going to Psalms 139? What are we talking about? You have to have a clear understanding of who your God is, that when the enemy comes and tries to convince you of who he is not, you can say, devil, I already know who he is, and what is known shall not be unknown. The only reason we are going through so much warfare is because we don't know Jesus. If I could tap into my podcast episode. So we're just talking about Jesus. Bible studies, church services are not supposed to always just be, oh, you're getting a house and a car tomorrow, turn around three times. No, all of this is literally to open your eyes. I pray that the eyes of your understanding are open. All of this is that your faith might be built. So I'm sorry if you only came to hear that it's all going to work in your favor. You didn't need me to tell you that. The Bible already told you that. What you do need is me to break the text down to give you a better understanding of who your God is, that you can walk away from this life deeper in your faith. The Bible says faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. How will they hear the word if not by a preacher? Preachers are only to spark you to believe. Not for houses, again, not for cars, not for things that are temporary, but to believe in God. Let's move. We're talking about Jesus, knowing him, not knowing of him, but knowing him. Where can I go from your spirit? Where can I flee from your presence? If I ascend into heaven, you are there. If I go up to heaven, you're there. We know that. That's not that surprising to me. If I make my bed in hell, behold, you are there. Meaning there is nowhere in this world that we can go where we are absent of the Father. God is with us always until the ends of the age. Ruth 1:16. Wherever you go, I'm going. Wherever you stay, I'm staying. So we think God's not hearing us. How can he not hear us if he's always with us? If I make my bed in hell, behold, you are there. Okay, I got excited because I started to think about the times that I was in hell. I mean, obviously, I didn't wake up like, let me go to hell today. But when I look back over the day, I came to realize that it was absolutely some fire burning around me. I tripped. I stumbled. I just made one less decision that got me trapped in hell. So I got excited about that. If I take the wings of the morning and dwell in the uttermost parts of the sea, even there your hand shall lead me and your right hand shall hold me. We're talking about the intentionality of God. If I take the wings of the morning and dwell in the uttermost parts of the sea, not only will you be with me there, not only will you be in me, around me, beside me, above me, and below me, but you're leading me. Even there, your hand shall lead me, and your right hand shall hold me. Do you understand everything is happening intentionally that you may know who God is? God says, I'm not just leaving you in heaven, leading you in heaven. I'm not just leading you in the good. I'm also leading you in the bad. Someone said the story of Job. Job's sin was thinking that everything was about him. I wanted to title this maybe subconsciously selfish. I think I was going to say earlier when I recorded my podcast episode, because sometimes we start getting too selfish. We start thinking too high of ourselves, thinking that it's all about us. No. God is with us always. Everything is happening on purpose, by purpose, through purpose, in purpose, for purpose. Even the more God is leading us in all things. When you give your life to Jesus Christ, you are then saying, I am relinquishing all rights and responsibilities to have this thing figured out by myself. I'm letting go of the need to control everything. I'm letting go of the need to overthink and to wonder and to worry. And I'm instead letting go of humanity, and I'm latching a hold to spirituality. I'm starting to trust him. I'm stepping out of thinking and I'm stepping into trusting. This is what happens when you give your life to Jesus. Then as the believer, When you decide to say, hey, I know I've given you my life, but I'm going to go ahead and grab it back and try to figure this thing out by myself, then it gets confusing. Then it gets complicated. Then it gets overwhelming. Then it gets frustrating because you've given it to God, but then you went on and taken it back. You didn't even understand it the first time you had it in the first place. Robin, where are you going? What are you saying? I don't know. I'm just trying to let y'all know that everything is happening intentionally. That the hell that you're going through is not just happening on purpose, but God is even leading you through it by his purpose. Sometimes that we think that we've stumbled into a place where we've disconnected from God. Maybe I've stepped out of God's will. Maybe me and God are not in alignment, as if y'all being in alignment was your business in the first place. No, God is leading you in all things. The Bible says he leads us in the path of righteousness for his name's sake. Even when we're faithless, Hebrews, even when we're faithless, he's yet still faithful. Even when we're faithless, he's faithful. Someone say he's faithful, which means it's not my responsibility to be perfect. It's not my responsibility to have it all together. It's not my responsibility to have it all figured out. All I need to do is present my body as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto God. He didn't say you make the sacrifice acceptable. He didn't say you make it holy. The sacrifice itself is acceptable and holy. All I need you to do is give it to me. God, what do you want from me? I just want you. Okay, we're just talking. Hallelujah. You got to know that God is with you. The devil wants to convince you that God is not with you, which is why it's important that your faith be built up properly. That when the enemy does come to attack your mind, which is essentially, he's aimed at just attacking your faith. We don't have an enemy that wants to hurt you in this world. We have an enemy that wants to hurt you for a lifetime, for eternity. Oh, debased people. People of simplicity, we have reduced ourselves to being lame. I'll just put that there. Thinking that we really have an enemy that cares about our house, our job, our business, our family, even generational. No, the devil cares about your soul. The devil cares about your soul. He wants you dead for eternity, which means when the enemy is coming after you, though it may look like it's all aimed at what's going on around you, he's only attacking what's around you to break what's in you, that being your faith. So it's important that your faith be built up properly, that when the enemy comes to attack it, you can withstand the storm. I'm reminded of the Bible that we're going to get here. I'll slow down. That says to build your house on the rock, not the sand. The rock is the word of God. Let's move. Or what man is there among you who, if his son asks for bread, will give him a stone? If you as a human ask another human for something and they give you what you asked for, why would God not go above and beyond, or rather just do the same? How is it we as people place people on a higher pedestal than God? Yeah. I'd rather pay for therapy and counseling than go to who the Bible calls my wonderful counselor. Instead of coming to Jesus, I'd rather go to somebody else. I want to ask everyone for their advice. I want to ask everyone for their opinions. Maybe, just maybe, if I asked God, he would give me that and even more. Understand, when people advise you, they're only advising you based off what they can see. All advisement is assumption. It's a difference between you advising me based off what you can see and me getting advice based off what somebody knows. God advises us based off what he knows. What does he know? He knows our purpose and our pain. He knows our up and our down. So when God advises us, he's advising us not in partiality, but in completeness. I'd rather go and ask my friends for help, but they can only help me on the surface. Baby, I'm not fighting anything that's surface level. I know it may look bad on the surface, but it's even worse when you dive deep within the layers of my existence. I've got to get help down on the inside. What man is there among you who, if his son asks for bread, will give him a stone? Or if he asks for a fish, will give him a serpent? If you then, being evil, This is Jesus talking to the disciples. We're just rehashing that moment right now. Jesus was talking to the disciples. If you then being evil, he called the disciples evil. I need you to understand that you are evil. I'm sorry. Maybe you thought I was going to say something different. No. Our problem in today's world, we have got so caught up with trying to be something that we have disconnected from the power that lies in us being absolutely nothing. For we have this treasure in an earthen vessel, that the excellence of the power, that the glory of the power may be of God and not of us. Sometimes our greatest asset isn't lying in our something, it's lying in the midst of our nothing. Jesus said, if you then being evil, but because you're evil, you have the opportunity to receive my good. If you then being evil, know how to give good gifts to your children. I'm going to say that a little bit better. Understand, if you were not evil, you would need Jesus. You would have no room for him. It is not your adequacy. It's not what you do right. It's not how amazing, how eloquent you speak. It doesn't matter how many degrees that you have, how saved, sanctified, and filled with the Holy Ghost you are. None of that matters. What matters is the places that you're dirty. What matters is the places that you're all messed up. Lord, with my mind, I'm trying to serve you, but in my flesh, I'm falling short. That creates space for God to show up in your life. I've said this before and I'll say it until the day of kingdom come. If God Elohim himself hovered over the face of something and tried to add to that something, there would be no glory. But because God hovered over the face of nothing, he gets glory for creating something. If you then being evil, if we could actually be authentic enough to say that we're absolutely messed up and I absolutely am a little bit bad as much as I want to be good, I'm then creating space for God to show himself to be true in my life. Because how can I know God is good if there's no bad to compare it to? If you then being evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your Father who is in heaven give good gifts, give good things to those who ask him? If you then being evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your Father who is in heaven give good things to those who ask him? Lord, I'm messed up. I want to be better. That's how you get the presence of God in your life. Yeah. People always, I'm learning to be intentional about highlighting problems and giving solution at the same time. How do I get to the place of strength in so much of my weakness? How do I get to so much abundance in the midst of my lack? I've got to take accountability for the fact that my righteousness is nothing but filthy rags. I've got to take accountability for the fact that maybe I'm not as good as I desire to be. Maybe I talk a game that I'm really not walking. Robin, you're all over the place. I'm really not, because I'm just in Matthew chapter 7. Judging you shall be judged. All of us are subconsciously judging, falling into this pit of condemnation because we are thinking we're better than other people, not understanding that the power lies in me being the least of them all. Paul says, I'm the least of the apostles, but I'm the greatest because unlike everybody else who wants to act like they're this and act like they're that and have it all together, I understand my power lies in my broken pieces. I understand that it's not about me trying to not be broken. It's not about me trying to be anything. It's about me taking every ounce of my brokenness and yoking it up to something that is whole. Yeah. I was just having a conversation. I said, yeah, we're absolutely broken for sure. But my power lies in my brokenness. Yeah. We focus so much on where we're wrong or what's wrong and not focusing on the God that can make it all right. I hope I can say it better like I know it. The power is in the brokenness. It's in the broken pieces. Broken pieces absolutely do have power. Somebody say, there is power in my broken pieces. If you want to shorten it, you can just say, there's power in my pain. But if you're really about it, say, there is power in my broken pieces. Broken pieces do have power. Not that the power comes from them, but it comes from what's fellowshipping. It comes from what's tabernacling with them. I knew I was going to have to go to John 15. I have it right here. I am the true vine. We're just talking Bible. I hear the Bible. I am the true vine and my Father is the vine dresser. Every branch in me that does not bear fruit, he takes that branch away. Y'all got to hear the text. But every branch that does bear fruit, he prunes. Wait a minute. God, you're telling me that I got to go backward, not because I've been bad, but because I've been good? You mean I'm getting cut down? You mean it feels like I'm being beaten? It feels like everything is coming undone, not because I've been bad, but because it's a confirmation of my good. Every branch that bears fruit in me, he prunes. I'm sorry, y'all don't like when I'm yelling. Let me stop. I'm sorry. The Bible just gets me excited. Every branch in me that bears fruit, he prunes. You know you're fruitful by the pruning connected to your life. Hallelujah. You know you're fruitful by the pruning connected to your life. You know you're fruitful by it. I know I'm fruitful. I know I'm effective by how many people don't like me. Y'all try to find confirmation in who does like you. I want you to start finding confirmation in who doesn't like you. I want you to start seeing your haters and smiling, saying, you give me purpose. I know I'm effective. If they didn't come on my comments talking about me, trying to bash the word of God, I wouldn't know that I'm effective. I wouldn't know that I'm doing the right thing. I wouldn't know that I'm just keeping my eyes set on Jesus. David said, I've got a lot of problems going on this level, but I look up towards the hills from which cometh my help. My help comes from the Lord. Bear with me. I find confirmation in the pruning. Those who do good, they may have to go through a little bit of bad. Every branch that produces something, I'm going to have to prune it, cut it. It's going to look back. It's going down, but it's only going back so that it can go up. I'm reminded of an arrow. The further it flies forward, the more backward it has to go. So because I've proven myself fruitful, because I've shown God that I'm productive, now it looks like my life is going backward, but it's just so that he can spring me forward. I'm going past every devil that tried to take me out. I'm going past everyone that talked bad about me. Yeah, no weapon formed shall prosper. It may look like the weapon has formed and is absolutely prospering, but I heard the Bible say that it won't prosper. When you've built up your faith on the rock and you know the word of God to be true, I don't care what it looks like. I heard the Bible say the just shall live by faith and not by sight. Say, I'm living by faith. I don't care what it looks like. I don't care what it sounds like. I heard the Bible say the just shall live by faith and not by sight. For I don't look at what is seen. What is seen is only temporary. It's what is not seen that's eternal. So I may see bad, but I know my bad is only but for a moment. For my current afflictions, my current experience is working for me a far greater glory. That glory I'm hoping for. And who hopes for what they have? It's a hope because I'm expecting it to manifest. If you're expecting God to do something in your life, I want you to say, I'm in expectation. I'm in expectation. How do I know that God is about to do a thing in my life? I know by the pruning. Hallelujah. I don't know by how good everything is. That's not the Bible. Everybody wants to get saved and thinks everything in Christianity is gumdrops, candy canes, and rainbows, as if our God was not crucified on a cross to deliver a people that hated him. Waiting for people to accept you, waiting for people to validate you, waiting for people to appreciate you, as if God came here on a mission of appreciation. If you're going to be a true disciple, if you're going to really serve Jesus, you have to be willing to do it without the validation. You've got to do it without the applause. Baby, I was on this live preaching, teaching, talking for hours when only 20 people was up in here. I have proof that it was 7 some days, but I wasn't doing it for the applause. I wasn't doing it for the validation. I was doing it for the purpose connected to my broken pieces. You have to be willing to do it in the midst of haters. You've got to be willing to do it even if it doesn't make sense. If I could tap into my podcast from earlier, I said, when Jesus got on this cross, if you read your Bible cover to cover, you'll find it in there. He did not know what he was doing when he got on the cross. Yeah. There are some things that God will call you to do that won't make sense and you won't be able to understand it, but you've got to be willing to move while confused. Some people like to just sit still, be still and know that I am God. I know. And so we say, I'm just going to be still until I get more clarity. I'm just going to be still until it makes more sense. Not understanding that if you really want to be like Jesus, you've got to move even while you're confused, trusting. It's something powerful about praying, God, don't give me clarity. Just equip me to endure the confusion. Yeah, Jesus went into the garden not knowing what the cross was for. He was a little bit confused. He went and said, Lord, I don't want to do it. Nevertheless, equip me to do what it is that I don't even understand. Equip me to handle the confusion. God, I'm not saying to tell me everything. That was our problem in Genesis 3. We wanted too much information. God, I don't need to know how it's all going to end. God, I don't need to know every single step of your plan. I just need you to equip me to keep my faith in the midst of the confusion. I just need you to equip me in it. God, I don't need you to change it, because the pruning is proof I'm fruitful. I just need you to equip me while I'm in it. God, if I can absolutely change it, please change it for me. I would love for it to be changed. Nevertheless, not my will, but yours be done. You're pruned because you're fruitful. Someone say, I'm fruitful. I'm fruitful. I'm fruitful. I'm fruitful. I don't care what people have told you. Life is not bad because you made a mistake or you messed up. Life is only bad because God is putting it back together for his good. That's why you can't listen to what other people say about you. You got to trust what God says about you. How do I know what God says about me? He wrote it in a love letter. How do I know? I'm fearfully and wonderfully made. David said, I'm fearfully and wonderfully made. Marvelous are your works, and that my soul knows well. Because I know who God is, I don't have to question who I am. I'm going to leave that there. Let's keep moving. You are already clean because the word I have spoken to you. Abide in me and I in you. As the branch cannot bear fruit of itself unless it abides in the vine, neither can you unless you abide in me. Yeah, broken pieces have purpose. Broken pieces have power. But the power is not of the broken pieces. It's in the God that takes them and dwells within the broken pieces and gives them purpose. Paul goes on to say, I burst in my infirmities. I boast in my infirmities. I boast in the areas that I'm lacking. I don't boast in what I do good because I don't need Jesus in those areas. I boast in what I do bad. Understanding that strength is only made perfect when I'm weak. Broken pieces. There is power in your brokenness. I'm not broken. I've got it all together. All of us in our own way are broken. You're not a Christian if you're not broken. Oh, baby, you thought that Christians had it all together. I don't know what lie you've been told. Baby, we don't have it all together. That's why we need Jesus. This is why the Bible says, judge not that you be not judged. I really can't judge nobody's messed up life because my life ain't that better. I can't judge nobody's filthiness and sin and nastiness. I'm not saying go out there and just be aimlessly broken. I know you can at least try to be whole. You can at least try to be healed. But truth be told, all of us need Jesus. All of us. The successful entrepreneur needs Jesus just as much as the doped up homeless person on the side of the street. All of us need Jesus. Yeah. Everyone's going through their own experience that we call life. One person doesn't know how they're going to pay the bills. Another person has so much money, they're trying to figure out what to do with the money. Yeah, I just want to pay my light bill. Another person just wants to do payroll this month. But all of us need Jesus. Someone else is going through a heartbreak. Someone else is going through self-hatred and self-sabotage. All of us need Jesus in some way. So when I can stop and when I can step out of trying to look down on other people and recognize I'm standing right down there with them, I can really get the glory that God has prepared for me. If I can move out of my own way. Our problem is that we try to do this thing called life by ourselves, man. You cannot do this thing called life by yourself. I had a great day yesterday. I reached out to Casey. I said, girl, I need you to pray for me. I'm having an iffy odd day. I didn't even go into it, but it was a chaotic type of day. I said, I need you to pray for me because you can't do this thing by yourself. We all need a savior. Absolutely. But I'll even say this. A lot of us only acknowledge God as our savior and not as our Lord. Robin, what's the difference? A Lord has rulership over your life. A Lord filters your thoughts, ideologies, feelings, will, and emotions. That's when Christ becomes your Lord. Until you surrender you, Christ is not your Lord. He's just your Savior. Thank you, God, for saving me. That's great, but that's only 50%. God so loved the world that he gave his only Son to save us. He's our Savior, but is he your Lord also? I don't know if I want to go there. That might take the conversation somewhere else. Is he your Lord? Let's go back to the text. Golden rule. Therefore, whatever you want men to do to you, do also to them. For this is the law and the prophets. This is the law and the prophets. I'm trying to take it to that level. Do you understand? There is a simplicity that lies in walking with God. There is a simplicity that lies in walking in God. All you have to do is say yes. All you gotta do is say yes. And not all you gotta do is say yes. We make this more complicated than it has to be. All you have to do is say yes. I've been saying this very frequently. I always want to give people the opportunity to know Jesus. I already told y'all. I want to highlight problems and provide solutions. All you have to do is say yes. God, I want you. Yes, God, I need you. Yes, God, I can't do this thing without you. At the confession of our yes, God says, I'm going to come and dwell with you in the midst of your yes. Sometimes we think yes is moving on from that moment, making the best decisions possible. No. Yes is saying, God, have your way in my life. Flowetry. Yes, have your way in my life. But I never promised to be perfect. The Bible says to be careful what you say, for your words will lead you to sin. Sometimes you put more on yourself than God requires of you. My burden is light. My load is not heavy. I'm not going to give you more than you can handle. When your relationship with Jesus becomes overbearing and overwhelming to the point that you start to even question your faith, you're doing more than God asked of you. All God wants is for you to say yes. Trusting that after you say yes, God is going to do the rest. I said the other day, I said, do your best to be your best and trust God to do the rest. Do your best to be your best. I posted a video talking about God's love because people need to hear that God loves them at the end of the day. We want to talk about God being the Lord of our life. That takes submission. Why would I submit to a God that doesn't love me? Submission happens when I step outside of religion and I step into relationship. A submission does not come. This is Bible study. When the law came in the Old Testament, the law came as our boundary to make us do right. Not right. It wasn't so much about, I want you to live this way, walk this way, and talk this way because I'm God and I just want things the way I want to. Even though if it was, he's God and he absolutely can do that. It was never so much about good or about bad. It was just about God. I'm setting up these laws that you can walk in God. Right? God realized, okay, y'all are making it more about religion and living up to this rule system and this law system that you can't even live up to, rather than just being in relationship with me and trusting that as you fellowship with me and connect with me, I'm going to change your desires. I give you the desires of your heart. I'm going to change what you want. So God said, I'm not going to have this religious law type of relationship with you. I'm abolishing that, or rather fulfilling that. And I'm going to give you my spirit, that by my grace, that by my peace, that by my strength, you will be equipped to then fulfill the law, walking in alignment with God. Am I making sense? I hope I'm making sense. I'm just trying to say it like I know it. So in the Old Testament, it was frustrating and it was confusing trying to walk in righteousness and trying to be saved. It was hard. Now God says, I'm making it easy. I'm taking away this perfectionism mentality and the need for you to have it all figured out. I don't want you waking up every day plotting, am I making the right step? No, I said the step was ordered. Just take the step. I don't need you overthinking the step. Instead, I want you to stick with me. When you say yes to God, you are opening yourself up to stick with him. I said this before. I said, I don't know when the day came that I stopped desiring to just be a hoe. And people will say it's a F-boy, a freaky type of person, right? You know, whatever, it works for you. You know what I'm saying? I don't know when that day came. I just stumbled on the day. I don't know when the day came that I decided I wasn't going to cuss and even be, I can't even say intentional about it. I don't know when that day came. Naturally, I just stopped cussing. And when it would slip out, I'd say, hold on, something ain't right in my spirit because I don't even cuss no more. I didn't sit down and make it a routine to stop cussing. The day just came. I heard the Bible say that at the right time, I, the Lord, will make it happen. I don't know when the day came that I stopped desiring to go out and just do craziness. I don't know when the day came that I stopped wanting to be in the world. I don't know when the day came that I stopped seeking after people and I started seeking after the God of my purpose. I don't know when the day came. All I know is that I've been walking with Jesus. And on that day, it came. On that day, I didn't make it about trying to be perfect. No, that's the problem. They preach a gospel of perfection, and that's not Jesus. I didn't make it about trying to be perfect. I didn't make it about having it all together. No, no, no. What y'all don't know is I was in the closet with a bottle of tequila saying, Lord, I don't know what's going on, but I need you, Jesus. God, I wish I was better. God, I wish I could be perfect, but I need you. And I found him. By my yes. I said yes, and he came and he started dwelling with me, and he didn't just leave me because things got bad. No, he says, if I leave you while it's bad, you'll never get to good. But because I'm gonna stick with you, in fact, what did the Bible say? Because I'm leading you through the bad, you'll end up at the good. Yeah, the Bible and tequila. This is real life. I'm sorry if you thought that I was perfect behind the scenes. I'm sorry if you thought that I came out the womb walking this straight line. Baby, I wouldn't have Jesus if I did that. No, I boast in my infirmities because it's my validation. That no, I really do know Jesus. Yeah. I got to make sure that I stay in prayer, that I don't give you me, I'm giving you Jesus. I'm sorry. Some days I don't feel like dealing with people, but I'm giving you Jesus, not Robin. Robin's messed up. But you're before us right now. Robin's dead. I no longer live, but Christ lives in me. I've been crucified with Christ. Now he lives in me. The life I once lived for myself, I now live for the Lord Jesus. Robin's dead. So I'm telling you the story about a death of a man named Robin. We're talking about a death of a man named Jesus. We're just talking about life and death. The dichotomy of the human experience is life and death at the same time. Though our outward man is perishing, our inward man is being renewed day by day. Though my outward man was perishing, with every sip that I took, something down in my spirit was getting stronger. Something down within my spirit was getting wiser. Now I can say I don't know of Jesus, but I know him for real. That even through the valley of the shadow of death, he will lead me. His rod and his staff will absolutely comfort me. So now I can tell you not about a God that I know of, but a God that I know. And it started with a yes. It started with a simple yes. God, just have your way. And because I just stuck with him, yeah, he stuck with me, but I also had to stick with him, right? God loves us all, but we have to also be intentional about receiving that love. Because I didn't allow myself to get in the way of it, because I didn't allow my own feelings of inadequacy and how I thought about or saw myself, because I did not allow that to get in the way, I just stuck with him. And lo and behold, here we are today. I'm no different. I'm no better. Judge not that you be not judged. I have to say, I'll be honest. I feel like Paul. I have this thorn in my side sometimes where this feeling, can I be transparent? Therapy moment. Where I start to feel like I'm better than people. This happens as you grow in God. Don't talk about me. You'll feel it one day. You're like, oh, really? That's what you do? That's where you go? As if I wasn't right behind them at one point. As if I wasn't sitting in the bar right next to them at one point. As if I was not you. I have to remind myself, nah, baby, I've been there. So then I'm challenged as a leader, speaking to my leaders, with having to reach your greater while not neglecting your lesser. True discipleship is about knowing how to live between the lines. True discipleship is not me learning how to live in the extreme. I don't want to live in the mundane. I've just got to live in between the lines. Can I go to 2 Corinthians, please? Can I? I won't go if you say no. I want to come back there. I'm just going to go to 2 Corinthians chapter what, Lord? 10. Thank you, Jesus. The Bible says, do not think of yourself higher than you ought. Let's go. We, however, will not boast beyond measure. 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 13. We, however, will not boast beyond measure, but within the limits of the sphere which God has appointed us. A sphere which especially includes you. Paul is talking to the church of Corinth. For we are not overextending ourselves. I'm not thinking of myself higher than I should think of myself. I'm not hyping it up. I'm not boasting it up. I'm thinking of myself within the lines, but within the limits of the sphere which God appointed us, a sphere which especially includes you, for we are not overextending ourselves as though our authority did not extend to you. For it was to you that we came with the gospel of Christ. Robin, where are you going? Follow me. I'll take you there. Not boasting of things beyond measure. That is, in other men's labors. Paul is saying, I'm not boasting in what someone else is doing. I'm boasting in what it is that I'm doing. I'm going to get there. Hold on. He's saying that the gospel cannot be built on someone else's foundation. If I can make it simpler, that's why there are so many churches. The gospel is to go into areas that it hasn't been preached. That's what's so powerful. We're in the New King James Version about this experience right now. The gospel is going into all of the earth, into areas that it has not been preached. Who would I be to go into someone else's church trying to preach the gospel there? Effective in one area, ineffective in another, because it's the same people, same thing. I'm already building on a foundation that's been built. Our challenge, our job as Christians is to go and build new foundation for people, right? Okay. Not boasting of the things beyond measure, that is in other men's labors, but having hope that as your faith is increased, we shall be greatly enlarged by you in our sphere to preach the gospel in the regions beyond you and not to boast in another man's sphere of accomplishments. Verse 17, but he who glories, let him glory in the Lord. For not he who commends himself is approved, but whom the Lord commends. If I'm going to glory in anything, it's going to be Jesus. I'm not going to think of myself higher than I am. The Bible goes on to say to be sober-minded, thinking of yourself within the measure of faith that God has given you. I'm not going to step outside of those lines. I'm going to think of myself within those lines. Robin, what are you saying? I'm saying, no, I don't think I'm better than anyone else, so I'm not going to look down on other people. What I am going to do is not become the very people that I've gotten away from. I hope I can say that a little bit better. I can't judge you, but I can absolutely be intentional about not going backwards. I'm not going to judge you because I've been there. I'm not going to look down on you because I've done that. But I also don't have to go back to that place. So therefore, I'm reminded of my pastor, Sarah Jakes Roberts. If it's good for you, it's good for me. I don't think I'm better than you, but I do think I'm better than the system. Maybe, just maybe, it's not about us comparing ourselves to each other, but rather comparing ourselves to the system. The system aimed at your detriment. The system aimed at your destruction. Someone asked if I went to Woman Evolve and I was talking. No, I didn't go. No. That is so crazy. People think Christianity oppresses you, not understanding that Christianity sets us free. I came to realize, and this is the point that I was trying to highlight with the Old Testament, God never set laws in place to restrict us. He set laws in place to give us true freedom. It's just that we started thinking the laws became a restriction, and we started feeling suffocated, and we started feeling like we couldn't do any good. The law that was meant to do good was seemingly doing evil. Christianity sets you free because freedom is not me going and drinking and smoking myself to death. It's not me sexing myself away. I don't know if you've ever seen it, but you can look at someone who has a lot of sex and see how it has polluted them. I'll leave that alone. We'll talk about that in a deeper spiritual class, okay? God set rules in place that we can get to actually living life and get out of death, right? Death is not me hanging out until 1 a.m. knowing I gotta wake up for work in the morning. I mean, life, that's not life. That's not good. That's not freedom. That's bondage. So when I give my life to Christ, he shows me that there's more. I really can find happiness outside of a joint. I really can find fulfillment outside of the club. I really can find healing in the midst of so much sickness. I really can find breakthrough, deliverance, restoration. I really don't have to be bound by my situation and circumstance. Christianity doesn't cage you. It opens up the cage that the enemy has placed us in to set us free. But if it's good for you, it's good for me. But as for me and my house, I will serve the Lord with gladness. If it's good for you, it's good for me. I don't think I'm better than you. I just think I'm better than the system. So if Christianity is oppressive to you, I heard the Bible say that if our gospel be veiled, it is veiled to those who are perishing. Somebody say I'm living. I know I may be in the world, I'm not of the world, I'm here, but I ain't really involved with the death that is plaguing society. I'm living. I'm living. I came that you may have life, and that more abundantly, that more abundantly. There's a more abundantly connected to your relationship with Christ. I know you said you're living, but I want you to say more abundantly, more abundantly, more abundantly. We're in Bible study. Can I pull up the scripture? Praise God for Google. John 10. I knew it was in John. The thief does not come except to steal and to kill and to destroy. But I have come, saith the Lord, that you may have life and that they may have it more abundantly. God has an abundance waiting for you. All it requires is your yes. If you want to get what not only God has for you, but what the universe, because there are people that serve the universe and they say, oh, the universe will be good to you and the universe will produce this for you. Absolutely. But the universe is only doing what God told it to do. So if you ever want to get to the place of actualizing what is possible and available for you, all you have to do is say yes. Let's go back to the book. Let's go back to the book. We're just reading the Bible. There are absolutely two ways of life. What verse is that I just said? What I said was the testimony of Jesus. John chapter 10 and 10 was the verse, but I'm about to back up what I just said with scripture. There are two ways of life. The Bible tells us to enter by the narrow gate, for wide is the gate and broad is the way that leads to destruction. And there are many who go in by it. Because narrow is the gate and difficult is the way which leads to life, and there are few who find it. I want you guys to understand that being a Christian is being a few. You are a few. There are probably more unbelievers than there are believers. I came to save the world, that the world through me might be saved. But that salvation is only connected to those who believe. A lot of people know of Jesus, but to truly believe in Jesus requires that you know him yourself. There are only two ways to life. I have the narrow way, and then I have the wide way. I can be like everybody else, or I can choose to be different. We live in a generation, we live in a day and an age, a society that puts more power behind trying to fit in than they do behind trying to stand out. Caleb, you can ask a question. I'm only answering what's relevant to the moment. I'm putting more power behind trying to fit in than stand out, as if God has called us to fit in and not be disruptive. If there's one thing that you're going to get from Robin, it's disruption. Baby, I'm putting on a conference in Atlanta, October 15th. I don't even know how I'm paying for it. I'm going to be there. It's going to be paid for. It's all going to be done. I don't know how, though. But I'm just going to do it. I'm just going to stand out. I'm just going to be disruptive. I'm sorry. I know everyone only wants to do what makes sense. I want to do what doesn't make sense. I want to do things that I need God to intervene for. God, if you don't do it, it won't get done. There was this quote that said, let's make unrealistic conversations with unrealistic goals normal. Let's normalize conversations with unrealistic goals. God did not call me to be realistic. Getting up from the grave is unrealistic. I don't know. That was good to me. I'm going to leave that where it is. It was unrealistic. If my God could get up from the grave. Hold on. Y'all not reading y'all Bibles. Y'all missed it. God did not only die for us. He went down to hell working for us. He went down to hell preaching, setting captives free. What type of God is working in hell? What type of God has power even in hell? That's unrealistic. There is no limits to his power. You mean even the demons obey you? Wow. Okay. So not only did he die, but he went to hell working. He went to hell working. He took the keys from the devil and said, I know you had these, but they're really mine. I need them back. Then he got up again. That's unrealistic. But it happened. And I know if God can do it and God is in me, with me and around me, I can do it too. Robin, That's amazing. You think in such amazing ways. I know that, but that's Bible. All things are possible to them that believe. Behold, you can do all things through Christ who will give you the strength. I just want his strength. Someone say, Lord, strengthen me. There are two ways of life. Lord, strengthen me. Lord, strengthen me. There is the way that I can go where I'm leading, where I'm guiding, where everything's about me. Or there's the path where I say, God, have your way. Lord, strengthen me. There is absolutely a path where I say, God, I just want your glory. Lord, I may not have it all together, no, but I'm gonna do my best to walk down this narrow road. Enter by the narrow gate, for wide is the gate and broad is the way that leads to destruction. Destruction is easy. Destruction is simple. Destruction is available for all. Disruption is rare. I want to know. I have a question for you. In a world of debased thinking, in a lame world, in a simple society, will you be the one that is disruptive? Will you be the one that decides to go against the grain? How are you a leader if you're not leading? You cannot be a leader if you're always following. Follow Jesus. Follow God. Don't follow man. I want y'all to know Bible. If Paul said this, can't remember what book, read it cover to cover. If you want it that bad, I'll Google it. He says, when I was given the gospel to the Gentiles, it's in Galatians, I know that much. When God gave me the gospel to the Gentiles, I didn't go back to people trying to be a follower because they would have told me the area that I was called to lead in was not the area I was called to lead in. So though God had anointed and ordained me to be a leader, I would have been a follower. Paul says, I didn't go back to the other disciples. I didn't go to Peter. It actually took him either a year or 3 years, if I'm correct, before he went back. Because he wasn't going back from a broken place, a place of wondering or insecurity. He went back in full confidence about who God has told him that he is and even who God is to him. Paul said, if I go to everybody else, I won't be disruptive. I'll be debased. Everyone would have been judging Paul. You were just killing Christians. You were just persecuting the very church that you're trying to build. Then Paul never would have been able to do what God called him to do. But if you read your Bible cover to cover, Galatians, y'all want me to go there? I want to go there myself. I'll go. We're in Bible study and we got a little bit more time to kill. We got a little bit more time to kill. Lord, where is it? Right here. Thank you, Lord. Chapter 2. Gospel of grace is approved by Jerusalem leadership. Paul didn't start doing it once it was approved. It got approved once he started doing it. I want you to start moving like it's already approved. I'm sorry. We're reading the Bible. We're just reading the Bible. Not too much. I want you to start working like it's already done. Anyways, if that was good to you, you can have it for you. It was good to me. Then after 14 years, I went up again to Jerusalem with Barnabas and also took Titus with me. I went by revelation and communicated to them that gospel which I preached among the Gentiles. I went up by revelation and communicated to them that gospel which I preach among the Gentiles. I'm bringing them back something that I've already done. I'm not coming back to them waiting for them to validate me to do it. I've already done it, been validated, and now I'm just bringing it back to you. You can either understand that God is way bigger than you make him to be. You can either understand that God cares also about the Gentiles and not just the Jews who were actually rejecting him. Or you can choose to live within your own human theology and ideologies and understanding about the Lord Jesus and a divine God. I'm going to leave that alone, but privately to those who were of reputation, lest by any means I might run or had run in vain. Yet not even Titus, who was with me, being a Greek, was compelled to be circumcised. And this occurred because of false brethren secretly brought in, who came in by stealth to spy out our liberty, which we have in Christ Jesus. I have liberty in Christ Jesus. Someone say, I have liberty. I have liberty. I have liberty. Liberty is freedom. I do believe. Oh, it's not getting me the definition. I think liberty is freedom. I don't know. Sounds like freedom, which we have in Christ Jesus, that they might bring us into bondage. To whom we did not yield submission, even for an hour, that the truth of the gospel might continue with you. But from those who seem to be something, whatever they were, it makes no difference to me. God shows personal favoritism to no man. For those who seem to be something added nothing to me. I want to talk to people who went to people who are seemingly something but gave you nothing. Yeah. I got confirmation to move forward in my ministry when I went to everybody who has the degrees to be something, yet they really couldn't offer me nothing. I'm gonna leave that alone. If God has given it to you, why do you need it from people? I'm gonna let that go. For those who seem to be something added nothing to me. But on the contrary, when they saw, God looks at the heart, man looks at the outward appearance. They're not going to appreciate you or validate you until they can see it. You've got to be willing to move in what's unseen, knowing that as you move in what's unseen, God will confirm it in the seen. When they saw that the gospel for the uncircumcised had been committed to me, as the gospel for the circumcised was to Peter. Peter was for the Jews. Peter was those of religious background, those who had it all together. They had it going on. They were Jews of the highest in social class at that time. Paul was given to the Gentiles. Hey, Jasmine. Paul was given to the Gentiles, people who worshiped idols, had no religion, wickedness, witchcraft, and magic. Peter got the good. Paul got the arguably bad. For he who worked effectively in Peter for the apostleship to the circumcised also worked effectively in me towards the Gentiles. And when James, Cephas, and John, who seemed to be pillars, perceived the grace that had been given to me, they gave me and Barnabas the right hand of fellowship that we should go to the Gentiles and they to the circumcised. They desired only that we should remember the poor, the very thing which I was also eager to do. Hold on, because I'm looking for something specific. When God gave me the gospel to the Gentiles, New King James Version. Oh, okay. Oh, thank you, Lord. I didn't read. Okay, we're going to go back a little bit. We're in the right place. I'm just... Okay, yeah. Galatians. Yeah. We're here. Okay, right here. We're going to go backward just a little bit. Gospel of grace is given by divine revelation. Chapter 1, we're going to go to verse 1. For do I now persuade men or God, or do I seek to please men? For if I still pleased men, I would not be a bondservant of Christ. You cannot serve Christ and men. He just wants to show up his iPad, y'all. In my business. For if I still pleased men, I would not be a bondservant of Christ. But I make known to you, brethren, that the gospel which was preached by me is not according to man. For I neither received it from man, nor was I taught it, but it came through the revelation of Jesus Christ. For you have heard of my former conduct in Judaism, how I persecuted the church of God beyond measure and tried to destroy it. And I advanced in Judaism beyond many of my contemporaries in my own nation, being more exceedingly zealous for the traditions of my father. When you know where you're lacking, you work a little bit harder. Yeah. When you know what you're up against, you have strategy on how to fight. I want to say it in a way, but if it's for you, it's for you. When you know the area that you're weak, you have to be intentional about tapping into what's going to make you strong. But when it pleased God, who separated me from my mother's womb and called me through his grace, when it pleased God to reveal his son in me, at the right time, I, the Lord, will make it happen that I might preach him among the Gentiles. I did not immediately confer with flesh and blood. Robin, why do you quote so much scripture as you're reading scripture? I want you to understand that all of the Bible is connected. The New Testament does not contradict the Old. The Old is not absent of the New. They go together. Right? Mm-hmm. To reveal his son in me, that I might preach him among the Gentiles. I did not immediately confer with flesh and blood. This is what we were looking for. I did not immediately confer with flesh and blood. But when it pleased God, when God chose to reveal his son in me, giving me the gospel to the Gentiles that was once only for the Jews, I did not immediately confer with flesh and blood, nor did I go up to Jerusalem to those who were apostles before me. But I went to Arabia and returned again to Damascus. Then after 3 years, I do know my Bible, I went up to Jerusalem to see Peter. After 3 years of me doing what God told me to do, I then went back to the people that once thought I was a nobody, and God confirmed that I'm a somebody. God confirmed that I'm somebody, even despite how much of a nobody that they thought I was. Listen, we're in Galatians chapter 2, but we're going actually back to Matthew chapter 7 because I want to tie it all together for you. Or wait, actually, we're going to 2 Corinthians chapter 10. Verse 18, for not he who commends himself is approved, but whom the Lord commends. Where are we going? Because it's almost time to go. Who the Lord commends. Paul said, because God validated me, I don't need the validation of anyone else. I've got two paths here. I've got two paths. I could take the road of people pleasing, waiting for people to appreciate me, waiting for people to value me, waiting for people to confirm me or give me approval to do something. Or I can take the road less traveled, which is to just trust in the Lord with all your heart, leaning not on your own understanding and all your ways, submitting to him. And he'll direct your path. I can either choose man or I can choose Jesus. Trusting in the Lord requires that this path requires you trusting in the Lord. Jesus said, be not lukewarm, be hot or cold. Just pick a side. I said live life in the middle, but I'm not contradicting myself. This is just something different. I don't want you to take this and pull it here. No, that applied to what I was saying then. This applies to what I'm saying now. You got to pick a side. I'm sorry. Picking Jesus does not mean perfection. No, he's perfect, the author and perfecter of our faith. We bring our imperfection into the presence of his perfection. Then when we get up off our knees and we come up out the room, we are then better than how we entered into it. But choosing Jesus doesn't mean perfect. It doesn't mean, oh, I messed up, now I've lost him. No, the Bible says that we are in his hand and that nothing can deliver us from that very hand. There are only two ways. I can say yes to God or I can say yes to man. I choose Jesus. I'm sorry. I know him to be true. I choose Jesus. And yeah, God, I've known better, but I couldn't have always done better. Lord, it got to the point that I did some sin. I sinned and I did some stuff knowing the word of God. And I had to sit back and say, God, you know what? That was not the devil. That was really me. And I'm sorry. I know him to be true. I had to be honest and say, okay, maybe, just maybe, I don't have it all together and find confidence in my broken pieces, knowing that my broken pieces have purpose. Knowing that my broken pieces have power. Sometimes we think that choosing Jesus means I have to step out of brokenness. No, choosing Jesus means that you are now serving a God who will come down into the midst of your brokenness and show you what healing looks like. Show you what wholeness looks like. Brokenness is an opportunity for you to have an experience with God like never before. Job should have started getting excited when his life became chaotic. He should have started cheering because I have the opportunity to know something about God that other people don't. I'll know that even if your body's falling sick, I'll know that even if all your money's been spent, I'll know that even if your family and your friends are forsaking you, that he'll still be everything that he is, because I am the Lord and I changeth not. He's the same yesterday, today, and forevermore. I'm going to Hebrews and we're leaving. I'm going to Hebrews. I'm going to Hebrews. I'm going to Hebrews. Chapter what? Oh, wait. I quoted the wrong scripture. It's not in Hebrews. We're going to Timothy. Maybe we need to go to Hebrews. I don't know. Something about Hebrews feels good in my spirit. We'll come back to it at the right time. Chapter 2. Okay. Verse what? Okay, I want you to hear this. The hardworking farmer, we're in 2 Timothy chapter 2, starting at verse 6. The hardworking farmer must be first to partake. Consider that I say, the may Lord give you understanding. We're going to go down to verse 10. No, we're going to go back up. Let's just read the Bible. The hardworking farmer must be first to partake of the crops. Consider what I say, and may the Lord give you understanding in all things. Consider what I say, and may the Lord give you understanding in all things. I'll leave that alone. Consider what I say. The Bible says in Matthew, we're actually going to finish Matthew. I mean, I'm going to fast forward. We're in Bible study, okay? I'm going to take my time. We got a little bit more time. We'll be out before seven. Okay? Consider what I say, and may the Lord give you understanding in all things. Remember that Jesus Christ of the seed of David was raised from the dead according to my gospel. And thank you to you who said that. For which I suffered trouble as an evildoer, even to the point of chains. But the word of God is not chained. I heard the Bible say the grass shall wither and the flowers shall absolutely fade. Heaven and earth shall pass away, but the word of God shall stand forever. My goal in my ministry is not to just prophesy, preach, and say a whole bunch of amazing stuff. My goal is to reconnect you with the word of God, because that's the only thing that will keep you. I'm central time. But the word of God is not chained. Yeah. The word of God is not chained. Paul, and I told you this before in the Bible, wrote the book of Ephesians from jail. The helmet of salvation, the breastplate of righteousness, the belt of truth, shod your feet with the preparation that comes with the gospel of peace. Take up the shield of faith, which quenches every fiery dart of the enemy, and the sword of the spirit, which is the word of God. Paul wrote about power in the midst of his pain. He was in prison, enchained, writing about freedom. I know why the caged bird sings, because despite a chaining situation or circumstance, I've got the word of God that is not chained. This is Bible. I'm not just talking about my own thoughts and ideologies. I'm just reading the Bible, verse 10. Let's keep it calm. Therefore, I endure all things for the sake of the elect, that they also may obtain the salvation which is in Christ Jesus with eternal glory and eternal glory. His kingdom has no end. This is a faithful saying. For if we died with him, we shall also live with him. If I die with him, I've got to first die with him, then I'll get to live with him. I've got to first let go to receive. I heard the Bible say to seek ye first the kingdom of God. Once you get the kingdom, you'll get everything else. For if we died with him, we shall also live with him. If we endure with him, if I don't give up, if I don't give in, if I keep on fighting in the faith, we are not of those, this is Hebrews, who draw back to the perdition, but we're of them who are intentional about pressing forward no matter what. Therefore, if we endure, we shall also reign with him. The definition of therefore, it refers to what you said previously. So everything that I said previously, what I'm saying now is built up on that. Therefore, because of that, if we endure, we shall also reign with him. If we deny him, he will also deny us. But nevertheless, the power lies in my yes. Yeah. Faith without works is dead. Meaning if I really do have faith in Jesus, my actions, my behaviors, my heart posture, my words, out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaketh, it should all reflect and confirm the very faith that I claim to have. Yet, even when we're faithless, he remains faithful. This is verse 13. He cannot deny himself. I know emotions change day by day. I had an attitude yesterday, but today I'm happy. I was doubting a little bit yesterday. Today I'm fully in faith. My yesterday was bad. Now today is good. I may have been frustrated an hour ago, but right now I'm back in peace. It doesn't matter how much I shift, shake, and change. God is yet the same. Even when I'm faithless, he's faithful. So even when I'm walking away from him, I heard the Bible say that surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, all the days. Because he's faithful. Even if I'm faithless, he's faithful. So what's your point, Robin? There are two roads. So even when I say yes to God, if I trip and stumble into being unfaithful, it doesn't change who he is. It doesn't change who he is. It doesn't change that before he formed me in my mother's womb, he knew me. He sanctified me. He ordained me. Before you formed me in my inward parts, you knew me. Before the foundations of the world, I was something to him. None of that changes. We're going to Matthew 7. Lord, I don't know why Hebrews just has me so bad. We're just going to have to do Hebrews on Sunday, maybe. If y'all join me for Sunday service on Sunday, we'll probably be preaching out of Hebrews. The Bible says, let not man say what they shall do, if the Lord be willing. I'm not going to say what we're going to do. God will say it at the end of the day. But if we are in Hebrews, you know why. You know why. Where are we going, Robin? Okay. Matthew 7. Service on Sunday is 1 p.m. Central Time, 2 p.m. Eastern. Bible study is normally Wednesday, but I think I'm going to change it to Thursday so it does not conflict with my Wednesday. Time Sunday, 1 p.m. Central, 2 p.m. Eastern. A matter of fact, just join my Discord. Click the link in my bio and join the Ascension Discord. I'll talk about that more, but I want to get back to the word. But my schedule is in the Discord. There are two ways of life. We talked about that. Verse 15 through 20, we're back in Matthew chapter 7. It talks about beware of false prophets. It's always on TikTok. Yes. Beware of false prophets. Beware of people who handle the word of God deceitfully. If you read your entire Bible cover to cover, it'll tell you multiple times that in the last days, 5 p.m. Central, that in the last days, right, there will be liars, people who are preaching false things and false ideologies. But you can have faith in knowing that everyone that preaches anything contrary to the word of God, they shall be cursed. This is Bible. Let's go here. I want to move forward. Every tree that does not bear good fruit is cut down and thrown into the fire. Therefore, by their fruits, you will know them. You will know a tree by the fruit that it produces. Believe what you see. I want to go here. And then we're going to close Matthew 7. I believe I'm at the end. Thank you, Jesus. 21. Not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, shall enter the kingdom of heaven, but he who does the will of my Father in heaven. I listen to you because you teach, you don't yell. I try. I get excited. I love the word. It gets me excited, but I try not to yell. Many will say to me in that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in your name? Have we not done all these marvelous and great things in your name? Yeah, you absolutely did know of me. But did you absolutely know me? Did you knew of me? Have we not prophesied in your name, cast out demons in your name, and done many wonders in your name? Yeah, you knew of me for sure. And then I will declare to them, says Jesus, talking to his disciples, ultimately his children. And then I will declare to them, I never knew you. Depart from me, you who practice lawlessness. I never knew you. Wait, you mean just because I operate in the things of God doesn't mean I'm operating in God? Just because I might be able to speak in tongues and quote a few scriptures does not mean that I actually know God? There's two paths. I never knew you. The true way into the kingdom. I want to say this and then we're leaving. The devil knew the word. Someone reads their Bible. It's important to know the word of God. So when the word of God tries to come up against you, you'll be able to rightly divide and discern which word is of God and which word is of the enemy. Though it may be the word of God, is it God? It's not about is it good or bad, is it God, right? It was the same word, it just wasn't God. In the 40 days that Jesus was tempted, the devil came and tried to use the word against him. He used the word against the word, but because the word was God, in the beginning was the word, and the word was with God, and the word was God, all things were in the beginning with him because it was God. It wasn't just that he had the word or knew the word, it was that he was the word. And because he was the word, he was able to discern what wasn't. I'll leave that alone. Hallelujah. Therefore, whoever hears these sayings of mine and does them, whoever hears these sayings of mine, that's great, you heard it. But are you doing it? Sometimes we're praying and asking God for our next, not working what he's given us for our right now. Therefore, whoever hears these sayings of mine and does them, you can hear it all day. Faith does cometh by hearing and hearing by the word of God. But the Bible says, be ye not deceived. Do not just be hearers of the word, but doers of the word. My question is, are you walking in the word? Are you joining these lives every Sunday, every Wednesday? For some of y'all, y'all be scrolling on TikTok just trying to get to somebody. Are you hearing and not listening? Or are you hearing to the point that it provokes you to listen? I'm walking in the word. I'm walking in the word. That was good to me. If you're walking in the word, say I'm walking in the word. Thank you, Casey. Are you walking in the word? Are you walking in the word? Whoever hears these sayings of mine and does them. I'm walking in the word. Does them. I'm not just hearing, but I'm also doing. God, you said do this conference. Okay, I'm not just hearing to do this conference. I'm doing it. What it's going to look like, how it's going to go, I don't know, but I'm just doing what I heard. I will liken him to a wise man who built his house on the rock. On the rock. I want y'all to hear the text because it speaks for itself. Therefore, whoever hears these sayings and does them, I will liken him to a wise man who built his house on the rock. The doing is having your house built on the rock. And the rain descended and the floods came and the winds blew and beat on that house. The Bible didn't say weapons wouldn't form. It just said that by your faith, they wouldn't prosper. By my faith, because I believe they won't prosper. Well, yeah, but I mean more so because you know Jesus, they won't prosper. And the winds blew and beat on that house, and it did not fall, for it was founded on the rock. What is the rock? The rock is the word of God. How do you know the rock is the word? Because verse 26 continues by saying, but everyone who hears these sayings of mine. Hold on, I want to go back. No. Verse 24, therefore, whoever hears these sayings, how do I know that the word is the rock? Whoever hears these sayings and does them, I'll liken him to a man that built his house on a rock. So when the winds blew and the storms came, it did not fall, for it was founded on the rock, on the word of God. It was firm on the word. So the grass shall wither, the flowers shall surely fade, but the word of God will keep me in the midst of everything that's trying to make me unkept. It's keeping me. The word is keeping me. His word keeps me. Yeah, I told you guys, the reason I know the book of Romans so well is because I looked in the mirror and I said, Robin, you are real messed up. God says, yes, you may be messed up, but I love you. Anyways, I heard the Bible say there is therefore now no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus. I had to stop saying that I'm filthy and I'm nasty, and I had to start saying that I'm fearfully and wonderfully made. Why? Because that's what the word of God says concerning me. I'm not just saying what I think about myself, because what I think about myself really ain't that good. I'm saying what God thinks about me. I'm the head and not the tail. I'm above and I'm not beneath. I know that book because that book set me free from self-condemnation. I built my life on the rock. But everyone who hears these sayings of mine and does not do them will be like a foolish man who built his house on the sand. And the rain descended and the floods came and the winds blew and beat on that house and it fell. And great was its fall. And so it was when Jesus had ended these sayings that the people were astonished at his teaching, for he taught them as one having authority, not as the scribes. He wasn't teaching like everybody else. He taught himself. Jesus wasn't teaching what he knew. This was the differentiation between him and the scribes. They taught what they knew from a place of their brain and their human intellect and understanding. Jesus was talking about what he knew. They were talking about what they knew. He was talking about what he knew. There's a difference. I hope you can hear me clearly. There's a difference. I want to give y'all two more scriptures and we're out of here. For real, for real. We're out of here for real. I'm on my 10th close, but we're out of here. I heard the Bible say something. It said in Hebrews chapter 12. Now, this yet once more indicate. Oh, I feel like I gotta go to Hebrews. I'm sorry. I'm sorry. Let's go to Hebrews. I only wanna give y'all a little bit, but I feel like I need to give y'all a lot. We're just gonna do this because this ties into what we're talking about. See that you do not refuse him who speaks. Hebrews chapter 12, we're gonna go to I feel like I want to read the whole Bible. Okay, we're going to start here. Let's move. See that you do not refuse him who speaks. For if they did not escape who refused him who spoke on earth, much more shall we not escape if we turn away from him who speaks from heaven, whose voice then shook the earth. But now, verse 1. Therefore we also, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, Let us lay aside every weight and sin which so easily ensnares us, and let us run with endurance the race that is set before us. Let us run with endurance. Let us run with endurance, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame. He didn't want to do it, and has sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. For consider him who pin the scripture, please. We're in Hebrews chapter 12. I'm going to walk the whole text. We just got to read the Bible. I'm sorry. I can't let it go. Looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and has sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. For consider him who endured such hostility from sinners against himself, lest you become weary and discouraged in your souls. It's saying, remember Jesus. Anytime that your faith gets shaken, just remember Jesus. You have not yet resisted to bloodshed, striving against sin, moving. And you have forgotten the exhortation which speaks to you as to sons. My son, do not despise the chastening of the Lord. This goes back to John chapter 15. God prunes those who are fruitful. Do not despise the chastening of the Lord, nor be discouraged when you are rebuked by him. For whom the Lord loves, he chastens and scourges every son whom he receives. If you endure chastening, God deals with you as with sons. For what son is there whom a father does not chasten? How can we say that we are children of God if there is not disciplinary measures, if we're not being built to better? Yeah, being in God does not mean I'm going to do whatever I want. We're talking about two ways of life. I'm not going to be however I want to be, but I'm going to be built into the image and the person of Christ, that in the end, I won't be presented to the Father as someone who acts like Jesus. I'm going to be presented to the Father as someone who is him. I'll leave that alone. We'll talk about that another day. But if you are without chastening, of which all have become partakers, then you are an illegitimate son. You're not sons. Furthermore, we have had human fathers who corrected us, and we paid them respect. Shall we not much more readily be in subjection to the Father of spirits and live? For they indeed for a few days chastened us as seemed best to them, but he for our profit, that we may be partakers of his holiness. God did it all for purpose. Now, no chastening seems to be joyful for the present, but painful. What I'm going through now isn't good and maybe bad. Nevertheless, afterward, it yields the peaceable fruit of the righteousness to those who have been trained by it. What you're experiencing today is training you. What you're experiencing today is preparing you. Everything is happening intentionally to set you up for the success of your tomorrow. Therefore, verse 12, strengthen the hands which hang down and the feeble knees. Be strong in the Lord and make straight paths for your feet, so that what is lame may not be dislocated, but rather be healed. Pursue peace with all people and holiness, without which no one will see the Lord, looking carefully lest anyone fall short of the grace of God, lest any root of bitterness springing up cause trouble, and by this many become defiled, lest there be any fornicator or profane person like Esau, who for one morsel of food sold his birthright. For you know that afterward, that's the story of Jacob and Esau. Go back to Genesis. For you know that afterward, when he wanted to inherit the blessing, he was rejected, for he found no place for repentance. Though he sought it diligently with tears, for you have not come to the mountain that may be touched and that burned with fire into blackness and darkness and tempest. You are not serving a God that you have to wait for to come down from heaven. You are not serving a God that you have to do a miraculous ritual to experience. No, you have not come to the mountain. This is speaking to the Old Testament, when Moses would have to go up to the mountain to talk with God, and the cloud would descend down from heaven, and that would be God communing with him. You have not come to the mountain that may be touched and that burned with fire into blackness and darkness and tempest, and the sound of a trumpet and the voice of words, so that those who heard it beg that the word should not be spoken to them anymore. When God spoke, it was so loud. Verse 20, for they could not endure what was commanded. And if so much as a beast touches the mountain, it shall be stoned or shot with an arrow. Robin, where are you going? Follow me. And so terrifying was the sight that Moses said, I am exceedingly afraid and trembling before the foundations of the earth. But you have come to Mount Zion, into the city of the living God. Living, 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 living God. Someone say, my God is living. My God is living. My God is living. People worship statues and idols of dead gods. My God is living. The heavenly Jerusalem, to an innumerable company of angels, to the general assembly and church of the firstborn who are registered in heaven, to God, the judge of all, to the spirits of just men made perfect, to Jesus, the mediator of the new covenant. He's the mediator of the new covenant. It's fulfilled in Jesus. And to the blood of sprinkling that speaks better things than that of Abel. Someone say the blood speaks. If we can get a little bit old school, I just want to tap into the old church for a moment. The blood speaks. The blood speaks. The blood speaks. My God is living and the blood speaks. The blood speaks. This is literally not exaggerating. Verse 24, to the mediator of the new covenant and to the blood of sprinkling that speaks better things than that of Abel. It's speaking to the blood of Jesus Christ that once he was pierced, our reconciliation, our resurrection, our redemption started dripping down from his side. So when he said, reach into my side and feel my wounds, my broken pieces, he was showing us that in order to get the glory out the thing, God might have to break it a little bit because his blood would not have flown had he not first been bruised for our transgressions. Our transgressions. I've got the Bible right here. He was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and by his stripes we are healed. Let's conclude the text because we got to go. See that you do not refuse him who speaks, for if they did not escape who refused him who spoke on earth, much more shall we not escape if we turn away from him who speaks from heaven, whose voice then shook the earth. But now he has promised, saying, yet once more, I shake not only the earth, but also heaven. Hear me, this is where I wanted to go. I just wanted to read the Bible because it makes me feel good. Now this yet once more, I shake not only the earth, but I'm also shaking heaven. Now, this yet once more indicates the removal of those things that are being shaken, as of things that are made, that the things which cannot be shaken may remain. Everything that can be shaken will be shaken, so that which cannot be shaken will remain. Therefore, since we are receiving a kingdom which cannot be shaken, I'm not receiving a Jesus that can be moved. All of the Bible goes together, but I'm receiving a kingdom which cannot be shaken. So I'm building my life, my house, on the word, the rock of God, because no matter what comes around me that tries to shake me, if I build myself on and in the kingdom won't be shaken. Therefore, I won't be shaken. Therefore, since we are receiving a kingdom which cannot be shaken, let us have grace by which we may serve God acceptably with reverence and godly fear. For our God is a consuming fire. Listen, I'm done. Our God is a consuming fire. Everything that can be shaken will be shaken, so that which cannot be shaken will remain. I want you to know that everything that's shaking in your life is only that you can come out the fire as pure gold. Yeah, when gold gets sent into the fire, it's hot to the point that it's burning every infirmity, burning every everything that's not gold, everything contrary to its purpose, everything contrary to its authentic properties must be burned off. So sometimes life gets a little bit hot, but it's a refining type of fire. It's a purifying type of fire to build you into the image of God, the image God intended you to be all along. We're on a journey to perfection. The day that we arrive at that place, we will no longer be here. We will be in heaven. The Bible goes on to say that we don't know what we shall be. I'm going to give it to y'all. We know not what we shall be. Truth be told, it's right here. I think it's right here. No, it's not. It's in 1 John. Let me go a little bit deeper. It's right here. Beloved, chapter 3, verse 2. Beloved, now we are children of God. I didn't even need Google. And it has not yet been revealed what we shall be. But we know that when he is revealed, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. All you got to do is stick with Jesus and say yes. not all go to heaven. That's a lie. That's absolutely true. Why is this is why it is so important for you to make a decision to just choose Jesus. This is exactly why everything is shaken. Everything gets chaotic. That's life. But all of the shaking is for a purpose. Everything that you are experiencing today, everything that is happening today is producing a far greater weight of glory concerning your life. I want you to know that it's only temporary. All of this is only temporary, absolutely true, yes. But I mean, what you're experiencing is only temporary. God allows us to go through things that we may get a lesson that equips us to handle the blessing. We're leaving. And we're going to read Psalms 34, and I'm leaving, literally. Grab your bags, grab your shoes, grab your clothes. We're leaving, okay? Y'all know I got to keep my towel handy. Where are we? Psalms 34. I don't know about you, but I'm at the place in my life where I'm no longer worrying, wondering. I'm no longer being swung to the left and to the right. This is what the Bible says, that he who doubts is just drug around. Okay, read your Bible cover to cover. As for me in my house, David said it, but I'm if I could just take his words as my own for a moment. I will bless the Lord at all times. Do I have any Bible readers? Say, I will bless the Lord. I will bless the Lord. If you really about it, say at all times. I will bless the Lord at all times. The Bible says that if we don't praise him, the rocks will cry out. I don't know about you, but I'm not letting no rock cry out for me. I will bless the Lord at all times. I'm not just waiting to bless him when it's good, but I love Jesus so much that I will bless him even when it's bad. I will bless the Lord at all times because I understand that it really isn't about good or bad. It's just about God. So I really can't allow bad. I can't define what's bad based on my own perception and understanding. I heard the Bible say that God would take the foolish things of the world to confound the wise. Maybe it's not bad. Maybe it's good. Maybe the cross isn't bad. Maybe it's actually good. The cross was good. Maybe what I think is breaking me is really just God trying to birth me. So if I reject the breaking, I'll never get the blessing connected to the birthing. I've got to be willing to bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. You can't praise God silently. I can't stand people who try to worship God silently. I know I'm not the master of worship, but I do know Jesus enough to know that my God is an audible type of God. If you're going to bless God, if you're going to praise the Lord, you have to do it with your mouth. Hallelujah. You'll hear me. Y'all ain't going to hear me. Y'all don't live with me or experience me in that capacity. But if you live with me, you would hear me say a hallelujah. I say a thank you, Jesus. I will bless the Lord at all times. I open my mouth. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. When I open my mouth, I invite him in to dwell with me. Psalms 117. I don't know it off top. What's Psalms 117? Hold on, because I feel like it'll be good to the point. I feel like it'll be good to the point. I feel like it'll be good to the point. We're Bible reading and we're leaving. We're Bible reading and we're leaving. Let all the people praise the Lord. All right, Christopher, we have some Bible scholars in the comments. I will bless the Lord at all times with my mouth. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. My soul shall make its boast in the Lord. I love you, Jesus. See, y'all think I just be doing that for show. I have people literally that say, they're like, I feel like you're just someone different behind the scenes. Baby, I'm not perfect, but I'm the same. I don't get on here talking Jesus and pretending for y'all. No, I really do just love the Lord. I really do. He's been good to me. My soul shall make its boast in the Lord. The humble shall hear of it and be glad. They overcame by the blood of the Lamb and the power, the word of their testimony. The humble shall hear of it and be glad. Do you understand that your praise sets other people free? Do you understand that when you lift up a hallelujah, when you lift up a thank you, Jesus, I could have cussed you out, but I'd rather just say thank you, Lord, for giving me another opportunity to walk away from what was trying to consume me. When you do that, people, it starts messing with people. Now you were coming to argue. I said, thank you, Jesus. Now you've humbled yourself under the mighty hand of God. It wasn't even about me, but you heard his name. I heard the Bible say that every knee shall bow and every tongue shall confess just at the name of Jesus. Do you understand? Demons start getting scared just at his name. When you start praising God, I heard the Bible say that the garment of praise was given unto us for the spirit of heaviness. Do you understand that demons have to back up off you when you start praising God? When the devil thinks that you're only going to praise God when it's good, he'll make your life bad. But when he starts to realize that you're going to praise God no matter what, I'm reminded of Job. Though you slay me, yet will I trust you. He starts to rest his attack. I just can't stop her. No matter what, she just won't stop praising the Lord. I just can't stop him. His faith won't be shaken. No matter what, the devil gets mad when you start praising God. Yeah. I praised God for some things that I have yet to see, because I don't need to see it to praise you for it. No. I'm going to praise you for it, and I know I'll have it because of the praise. Yeah, I praise God on credit. I praise God on the deposit. God, I'll just believe you enough. Even if you don't do it, just keep the credit. I trust you enough. Your word is good. You've got good credit in my book. My soul shall make his boast in the Lord. The humble shall hear of it and be glad. Oh, magnify the Lord with me and let us exalt his name together. I just want you to say hallelujah. See, we say all the time, oh, praise the Lord, as it's a game. No, praise the Lord means hallelujah. Do you understand that hallelujah in itself is a command to praise? So when I say hallelujah, you should say it back, because I'm not just saying hallelujah for fun. I'm saying hallelujah to spark a praise. As praises go up, blessings come down. Hallelujah is a command. I will bless the Lord. So if you're having a bad day, I'm commanding you to hallelujah. If you want to get into the theology, hallelujah. It's a praise. Oh, magnify the Lord with me. I'll do it by myself, but there's a power when two and three are gathered, and let us exalt his name together. All right, we're reading. I sought the Lord and he delivered me from all my fears. I sought the Lord and he heard me and delivered me from all my fears. They looked to him and were radiant because I chose to praise the Lord even in the midst of my pain. Now they want to know, what type of God are you serving that even when it's bad, it's yet still good for you? I want the joy that the world didn't give and the world can't take away. I want to know who your God is. That's what being a disciple is about. The Bible said, don't boast that you have power and authority to tread over serpents and scorpions. That's good. That's common sense as believers. I want you to instead boast in how good I am, and that your names are written in heaven, so that other people will be provoked into believing. This poor man cried out, and the Lord heard him and saved him out of his troubles. The angel of the Lord encamps around those who fear him and delivers them. Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. Taste, experience. I don't have to just see that the Lord is good, but God wants me to have a personal experience with his goodness. Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. I'm reminded of my Chick-fil-A that's sitting beside me. I can't wait. Blessed is the man who trusts in him. Oh, fear the Lord, you his saints. There is no want to those who fear him. The young lions lack and suffer hunger, but those who seek the Lord shall not lack any good thing. I'm reading Bible. I want y'all to hear the Bible so that even when I'm not live, even when I'm not here before you now, your faith is not shaking. You're not wondering and worrying. I'm reading to you the Bible. If your faith is shaking and you're wondering how it's all going to work out, all you have to do is open up the Bible and read it. There is no want to those who fear him. There is no want to those who honor him. There is no want to those who reverence him. The young lions lack and suffer hunger, but those who seek the Lord shall not lack any good thing. Our focus text today was Matthew chapter 7. And I heard the Bible say that if you seek, you'll find it. If you keep reading your Bible, I heard it say, I did not tell you to seek me in vain. I told you to seek me that you might find me. I heard the Bible say that he's a rewarder of them that diligently seek after him. But those who seek the Lord shall not lack any good thing. Maybe what you're lacking, maybe you're not lacking anything that you need. Maybe what you're lacking is just bad. Maybe you've got everything that you need for good. Come, you children, listen to me. I will teach you the fear of the Lord. Yeah. This word fear also means reverence when we dive into the Hebrew and we get into the foundational theology that backs it up. But sometimes we're so boastful about the goodness of God that we stop obeying him, because he still is the Lord God El Elyon, the Lord God Almighty. There is still an ounce of obedience required in our relationship. I will teach you the fear of the Lord. I'm going to go here and I'm leaving. Everyone honors David for being the greatest king. No, David was the greatest worshiper, which then made him the greatest king. Who is the man who desires life and loves many days that he may see good? Keep your tongue from evil. You got to watch what you say, and your lips from speaking deceit. Depart from evil and do good. Seek peace and pursue it. Seek peace and you'll find it. Pursue it. Pursue peace. I'm seeking peace, finding peace, and I'm pursuing peace. I'm not leaving peace on the ground. I done picked it up and I'm carrying peace with me everywhere that I go. The Bible would say that if you enter into a city and they don't receive your peace, to just shake off the dust, because peace is with you always. The Bible says to shod your feet with the preparation that comes from the gospel of peace. God says, I want peace on your feet, that you're not waiting for a situation to be peaceful. But I want you to know that just because you stepped into something that was chaotic, it has to come into alignment with your peace. I'm gonna leave that alone. We're just leaving. The eyes of the Lord are on the righteous, and his ears are open to their cry. Our righteousness is as filthy, dirty rags. It's nothing. So when it says the eyes of the Lord are on the righteous, it's not speaking to human righteousness, not by works, but by faith. By faith, I've been made righteous. By grace, through faith, I've been made righteous. So the eyes of the Lord are on all believers, and his ears are open to their cry. The face of the Lord is against those who do evil, to cut off the remembrance of them from the earth. The righteous cry out, and the Lord hears them. I'm ending where I began. The righteous cry out, and the Lord hears them and delivers them out of all their troubles. The Lord is near to those who have a broken heart and saves such as have a contrite spirit. He's near to the weary and the brokenhearted. Many are the afflictions of the righteous. Yeah, you're going to have to go through some stuff. Your experience will not be gumdrops, candy canes, and rainbows. Many are the afflictions of the righteous. I told you, the pain is only confirmation of your purpose. The bad is only an indication of the good. The pruning is only an indication of how productive you actually are. Many are the afflictions of the righteous, but the Lord delivers him out of them all. Not just some, but all. All things work for the good of those who love the Lord and are called according to his purpose. Not some things, not just a specific category of things, but all things work for good to those who love the Lord and are called according to his purpose. He guards all his bones. Not one of them is broken. 1,000 may fall at your side, 10,000 at your right hand, but it shall not come near you. Only with your eyes will you look and see the destruction of the wicked. That's Psalms 91. He guards all his bones. He that dwelleth in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. Verse 20, he guards all his bones. Not one of them is broken. I'm reminded of Jesus. Not one of his bones was broken. They broke the bones of the man next to him, but they didn't touch Jesus. They didn't break his bones, as an indication that no matter how bad it gets, I'll never allow it to break your bones. What's a bone? It's a structure. As long as you have your house built on the word of God, your structure will never be broken. He guards all his bones. Not one of them is broken. Evil shall slay the wicked. Only with your eyes will you look and see the reward of the wicked. I don't even have to worry about killing my enemies. My enemies are killing themselves. Evil shall slay the wicked, and those who hate righteousness shall be condemned. The Lord redeems the soul of his servants. And we're leaving. Hallelujah. The Lord redeems the soul of his servants, and none of those who trust in him shall be condemned. Listen, if I could leave you with anything on today, I would leave you with an opportunity. Love you, Robert. I'm not Robert, but I love you back. I would leave you with an opportunity to choose Jesus. Understand there is power in your broken pieces, but you can only use that power, actualize and access that power, if you yoke that brokenness up to something that is whole. You gotta yoke your lack up to something that's abundant, right, Robert? What's going on here? You've gotta yoke your nothing up to something. Yeah, all of us are broken. We all got broken pieces. I'm sorry. And if you think you don't, you can be prideful all you want to. I have broken pieces because my brokenness is an indication of how bad I really need God. God, if they're not broken, they don't need you. I'm broken. I need you. So now I've got power in the midst of my pain because I've taken my pain and I've yoked it up to the God of my purpose. There is power in your broken pieces when you bring them into the presence of God. I need you. Casey, you're well in my spirit. Someone say, God, I need you. I need you. God, I need you. And we're going to prayer. God, I need you. God, I need you. I need you. I know the world tries to make this something that it's not. I know they try to hype up Jesus and make it more than what it needs to be. Baby, the word of God does it all by itself. I don't have to sit up here and do anything more to it. God, I need you. I need you. I need you. I know people need you, Lord, for houses and cars. We're going into prayer. Cars, Lord, I know people need you for everything externally. They want you for what you have in your hand. God, we need you for who you are in our heart posture. God, we need your heart. Lord, absolutely. Your word says that you desire above all things that we be in good health, that you desire that we prosper and be in good health as our soul does prosper. This is what you said concerning us. So, Lord, I know that you do desire us to prosper on the outside. But God, so many of us are seeking prosperity on the outside while living in pain on the inside. God, I pray that we begin to yoke our brokenness up to you, that we can have true fulfillment, not fulfillment validated by anything external, not fulfillment validated by anything that the world can give us, not fulfillment validated by how much money we're making or how many places we're going to, but God, we want to be filled from the inside and then our outside be a reflection of what took place on the inside. God, we want to be healed for real. God, we don't want to be seeking subconscious healing. God, I know that you go beyond my words. I just want to say it a little bit better. I don't want us to subconsciously give ourselves to stuff that is not good to us. God, I don't want us going to the club really looking for you. I don't want us going to have sex with people really just looking for you. God, I don't want us to say we're suicidal, cutting our wrist when really we're just looking for you. God, if we're ever going to get to the place called peace, it has to happen on the inside. God, I'm thankful. Father, I'm thankful that you've placed treasure down in something so meaningless, power in something so powerless, purpose in something so purposeless. But we have this treasure in an earthen vessel. God, I'm thankful that you're in us. I'm thankful that I don't have to wonder if you're with me because you're in me. I'm thankful for your angels that encamp around me, but I do know that your Holy Ghost is within me. So God, I'm thankful for the in that lies in you. There is no, therefore now no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus. Trust in the Lord with all your heart. Lord, I'm thankful for an in. God, I'm thankful. I will bless you at all times, Lord. I'm thankful that I can lift up a praise to you. I'm reminded of way back in the day in the Bible times that they would want to lift up a hallelujah and they couldn't. We can, but we don't lift up a hallelujah. They were persecuted, yet not forsaken, struck down, but not destroyed, always carrying in the body the dying of the Lord Jesus, that the life of Christ might be manifested in our mortal bodies. They couldn't say hallelujah because of their situation and their circumstance. They had to hide in caves and hide behind doors and walls, making sure no one was around just to say hallelujah. God, we have the opportunity to say hallelujah at any point in time today, but we'd rather curse each other out instead of just say hallelujah. We'd rather argue and bicker and debate and go back and forth instead of just lifting up a hallelujah. Lord, let us walk in your word to not judge each other, that we might not be judged. Let us live by the golden rule to treat people the way that we want to be treated. God, let us get back to the place of authentic faith, the place where we can experience authentic peace, the place without restrictions. I heard the Bible say that your word is not chained. God, if we're ever to get to the place of really being free, it doesn't happen in the world. It happens in the word. God, I'm thankful. I'm thankful for the freedom that lies within your word. I'm thankful that our mind gets set free by your word. I'm reminded of Jesus who after he got tired of dealing with the enemy, he spoke the word. He said, you shall not tempt the Lord thy God. It is written that you shall not tempt the Lord thy God, and Satan departed from that moment. Father, I pray that we start speaking your word over every single demon playing with our mind, our emotions, our understanding. I pray we start speaking your word over our situations and our circumstances. I pray that we stop speaking how we want it to go and we start speaking how the word says that it's going to go. I heard the Bible say that you prepare a table for us in the presence of our enemies. I don't have to say, oh, I want it to work out. I heard the Bible say all things are already working out. I don't have to wonder how it's it's going to go. I heard the Bible say that everything is working at the counsel of your will. So all things are happening in purpose, by purpose, on purpose, and through purpose. You're intentional. God, I thank you for your intentionality on today. Yes, we wonder. Yes, we doubt in moments. But God, I'm thankful that even when we're faithless, you're faithful. I'm thankful that you're the same, God. I'm thankful that whenever we feel like we've gotten away from you, that we can go back to that last encounter and you'll be there just sitting and waiting on us. I'm reminded of your word that Peter, when he thought he lost you, went back to the place where he found you. And though he didn't expect to find you in that place, you're the God that shows up in the places. I don't know, but that felt good to me. You're a God that shows up in the places. Even if we make our bed down in hell, you'll find us. Your right hand shall lead us, God. I'm thankful that everything is set up for our success. Even if we can't understand it, even if we can't comprehend it, Peter went back to that place, and lo and behold, you were right there waiting on him. They sailed and they came upon the place and they looked, they said, that looks like Jesus. That looks like Jesus. Well, not they. Peter knew. There's a difference between knowing of you and actually knowing you. Oh God, it doesn't matter what you're wearing. It doesn't matter how you dressed up. When we know you, we know you. So God, I'm thankful for the ability to know you on today. I'm thankful for the availability to know you on today, oh God, that when I can see you, I'm able to point you out. I'm able to recognize, no, that's Jesus. And even more, we're able to discern what isn't you. God, I'm thankful for how you show up for us. I'm thankful for how you keep us. I'm thankful for how you carry us. I'm thankful that you love us far greater than we could ever love ourselves, God. For you chose us. We did not choose you, but you chose us. God, I'm thankful to be chosen by you. Lord, you could have chosen anyone. We could be doing anything, but God, you've chosen nothing. From dust we came, to dust we shall return. The power lies in our nothing. That in the midst of all of that nothing, you placed an abundance of something. So God, here we are broken. We present before you broken pieces. Everyone's broken is manifested and expressed differently. But God, it's all just brokenness. So we lift our hands and we surrender to you. We lift our hands in surrenderance, oh God, saying, have your way. Let your will be done, oh God. Let your purpose come into manifestation in our lives. God, we move out the way. God, we need you. We just want more of you, oh God. I wish we could say that we had it all figured out. But truth be told, we don't. So Lord, we need you. Father, I thank you. I thank you because if we go back to your word, it says that you'll do it not because we prayed it, but because we believed it. So God, we place our faith on this word, on this prayer, saying, Lord, have your way, and it is done. I don't know, Lord. I didn't come to you with eloquent of speech, with perfect phrases. I'm just me. I'm just being simple. God, have your way. Lord, give us fresh faith on today. A now faith, a now hope that won't disappoint us, that won't let us down, that won't let us go. Oh God, give us something for our now. Father, I thank you. In Jesus' name, I pray that as we depart from this moment, it be not an ending, but a beginning. I heard the Bible say that if two agree on anything that they ask, that it shall be done. So God, I'm in firm expectation. Yes, but God, I thank you that everything that we've asked for shall be done. Why? Because your word said it. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Thank you for your word. 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 Thank you for your word, Lord. Anyway, we're here, right? I want to tell you guys a couple things. Number one, I'm doing a conference in Atlanta. It is not going to be live streamed. It's only $20, okay? It's just $20. You can click the link in my bio, go on therobinboynton.com. It's a specific link, and register. If you cannot come in person to Atlanta, Georgia, you can watch online, but it will not be via live stream. You will have to get a link because it's going to be an intimate encounter. This is me. This is going to be like a ministry launch, though I've been doing ministry for 4 years. This is going to be a revival experience. We're going to Atlanta. We're going to I'm in Dallas. We're going to do Houston, and we're going to do LA. Anywhere else, we shall see when. October 15th, 7 p.m. Atlanta, Georgia. All the information is in my bio, number one. Number two, Houston. I don't have a date for Houston yet. I'm going to try to be in the building. Dallas, when? None of that is happening yet. It's going to be October 15th is going to be Atlanta. I don't know when the other ones. My heart is set on Atlanta right now. And so, number two, Join my Discord. I want you guys to connect with me. You'll keep waiting. Keep waiting. It won't be long from now. I want to see you guys there. So y'all don't just be coming on live and then don't come see me in person. Okay? Why is it $20? Are you charging for ministry? Oh my God. This stuff costs. Duh. I'm not doing this to lie in my pockets, baby. It costs to put on events. If y'all want to just have a live experience on TikTok, we can just do TikTok live. But why stop there when there is so much more? But in order to do that, I'm sorry, everybody don't want to do stuff for free, okay? I wish they'd give us the building for free, but baby, buildings cost money, okay? Let's move. Y'all can join the Discord. I want to connect with y'all outside of these moments. The Discord is called Ascension. It's about rising higher, going higher together. It's built off of Mark chapter 16, when Jesus ascended and was seated at the right hand of the Father. I want you guys to be seated. A seated is completion, is fulfillment of everything that he ever set out to do. He was seated. I want you to join this community of people who are going through the same things that you're going through, or rather having already gone through it. So they have wisdom to offer. They have strategy to offer you. We're all aligned by our faith, but we have different experiences. So please consider coming to Miami. Miami is on the list. I didn't name Miami because these were the first ones, but Miami is coming. Atlanta is a big place. Which part? Actually, Atlanta is not that big. Georgia is big. I'm speaking to literally downtown Atlanta. It's going to be at the Hyatt Regency in downtown Atlanta. Robin, are you just saying that? No, that is the date. Property has confirmed that. All that is good. It's going to be October 15th. Will I ever come to New York? Yes, I'll be coming to New York. It's going to be a revival tour. It's going to go, New York is going to be one of the places, but I'll of course let you guys know as it goes. As of right now, it's Atlanta. Robin, why Atlanta? Because when I look at my analytics, Atlanta, Houston, South Africa, shout out to South Africa, are my highest areas of engagement right now. You'll come to London too. I received that because I was going to say Europe. Yes, I'll be going to the UK as well. St. Louis, not that I'm not too sure. I can't speak on that one. We shall see. If y'all want me to come to St. Louis, we can come to St. Louis. This is the revival tour. Wherever revival is needed, we're going to be there. Houston in the building. We're going everywhere. Basically, Casey, at this point, we're going everywhere. And I hope y'all don't think I'm playing. No, this is an actual real revival tour. I'm not just talking. This is being strategized as we speak. When is Bible study on live? I feel like I'm going to move the day to Wednesday, 5 p.m. Central, 6 p.m. Eastern. I'll see you in South Africa for sure. Live replay will be posted on my YouTube channel. Everything is in my bio. Come on, Christopher. All you have to do is click the link tree. That's right. Lead by the Holy Spirit. God, absolutely. Click the link in my bio and it literally says live replays, Discord, the revival experience, the revival tour. All of that good, great stuff is there. He's not coming to Africa, y'all. I will be coming to South Africa. I do firmly believe before the end of this year, we shall see what God is going to do. The Bible says, let not man say what he's going to do, but if the Lord be willing, if God be willing, if God be willing, I'll see you in South Africa this year. Nevertheless, I think that's all that I've got for you. I met Robin, by the way. Love you. Have a good night. Oh, you're fine, Jason. I know that. We've connected personally. I'm not that shallow. Do you have a word for me from God? I do. Read your Bibles. Listen, may the Lord bless and keep you and cause his face to shine upon you. I pray that you walk away from this moment experiencing the peace of God like never before. I know him to be Jehovah Shalom. So, we kept typing on your behalf too. All right, y'all. I really don't have anything else, so we're out of here. Okay, peace out, y'all. Join the Discord so y'all can connect with me and the people in the Discord. We're up to 160-something people now. I can give y'all the exact number and then I'm leaving. 171. Okay, y'all was joining already. We're up to 171 members in the Ascension Discord. I don't want you to have fear of missing out, but if you're not in the Discord, you're missing out, okay? You're missing out. Now, I don't expect me to get in there and be a chatterbox, which is why I'm telling y'all to join so that it can be a community cultivated by y'all also, because I'm not really a chatterbox. I want to make sure I say stuff that's necessary, you know? So how do you join? Just click the link in my bio, and it'll say, join the Ascension Discord. Let's go higher together. I am focused on introducing people, leaders, to the best version of themselves. We do all this self-help. They got shadow books right now. But None of that is really leading you to your best self. Robin, how do you know? Because your best self is only found in Jesus. So yeah, we're going to work together in marketplace. We're going to grow together in ministry. But all of that has to start with Jesus. In this day and age, it's imperative, it's important that you are connected with people who not know of Jesus, but who know him. You have to be, you need to be connected to people that know Jesus. And if you don't, join it so you can. That's all I got for you. What is the shadow book? RFYPs might be different. I'm hanging up in 3, 2, 1. I love you. I thank you, Casey, for modding. I love you, Casey. Christopher, I thank you for modding. I love you. Strong Complex, I thank you for modding. I love you. Thank you. I love all of you. Next level up. Thank you. I received that. That is this year. And we're out of here. I love all of you. I love you too, Tay Swiss. And peace out. I love you deep. I love you deep. It says the Discord link expired. If that's the case, reach out to me, but it should work. Try downloading the app. Someone said try downloading the app and going from there. I don't know, but I'm going to put a new link in the bio right now to make sure that it's good, okay? Hey, Kay, I'm going to call you later today, actually, so we can catch up. I love y'all. Peace out.